This is a tree? Yeah, merger, very well. So, thank you. Pe toți, bine ați venit la casa Domnului. E ceva nepotrivit, nu e așa, că eu un străin acum vin și începem serviciu și tot, dar o să fie ceva cam nepotrivit seara asta, așa, nu nepotrivit, potrivit, dar neobișnuit. Neobișnuit. Haideți să ne ducem la cântarea 528. O să cântăm prima strofă în limba română. Thank you.
prima strofă în engleză. Ready? Nearly got it. Almost there, yes? Așa e la început, până ne obișnuim, nu-i așa?
Yeah.
Așa este. Oh, Lord, my God,
toate lucrările tale, suntem uimiți de ceea ce ai făcut în univers, de tot ce este în jurul nostru, de toate ființele pe care le-ai creat, de tot
ceea ce ai făcut pe pământul acesta și l-ai făcut pentru binele omului. Dar cel mai mult ne bucurăm, o Doamne, când te întâlnim în Cartea Sfântă, unde vedem minunatele îndurări ale tale față de noi, oamenii care eram departe de tine, dar pe care ne-ai căutat, ne-ai găsit și ne-ai pus în turma ta. Îți mulțumim, Doamne, pentru îndurarea, pentru mila ta, pentru că ne-ai iubit și pentru că ne conduci prin binecuvântări zi de zi. Suntem adunați și în seara aceasta, în locul acesta, să-ți dăm slavă numelui tău. Dorim pe toți să ne binecuvintezi, dorim să luăm aminte la ceea ce vrei să ne spui din cuvântul tău. De aceea te rugăm să binecuvintezi slujitorul tău, pe fratele Ghiță, între noi și să-i dai mult har și binecuvântare, ca să poată tălmăci Scriptura pe înțelesul nostru, iar nouă, dă-ne urechi și inimi deschise și să ne bucurăm că putem intra în Cartea Sfântă, să ne bucurăm de lucrurile tale minunate. Domnul nostru, dorim ca seara aceasta să fie cu un folos spiritual pentru fiecare care suntem aici. De asemenea, te mai rugăm, Domnul nostru, să te înduri de cei care, din motive de sănătate, de neputință, nu pot să fie cu noi în seara aceasta. Binecuvântă-i la casele lor și dă-le mângâierea ta. Fie ca și prin intermediul transmisiei online, mulți să primească cuvântul și să fie zidit sufletește. Pentru tot ceea ce vei face, Domnul nostru, noi cu recunoștință, cu mulțumire ne închinăm și te lăudăm. Amin. Vă rog să vă așezați. Mulțumim tuturor care au putut să vină în seara aceasta aici. Domnul să ne binecuvinteze pe toți la cuvântul Său. Mulțumim Domnului că fratele Ghiță cu sora Moțoc au venit și au ajuns cu bine la noi în seara aceasta. Cu bucurie le spunem bun venit și zicem ca Domnul să-l folosească pe fratele Ghiță cu mult har între noi. E o seară mai deosebită, dar ne vom adânci în cuvânt. Nu facem altceva decât să ne aprofundăm mai mult în cuvântul Scripturii, care ne face bine sufletului nostru, să ne mai îmbogățim un pic în relația noastră cu Domnul și Mântuitorul nostru Iisus Hristos. De aceea, în seara aceasta o să avem cântările comune, primordial, și fratele va avea mesajul Scripturii pentru noi, în două faze al programului acestuia din seara aceasta. Vreau să amintesc familia săptămânii, să nu uităm să ne rugăm pentru frații noștri, familia Cazacu, Grigore, Tamara și Jennifer. Domnul să-i binecuvinteze și pe ei. Nu uitați, la casele noastre, să ne rugăm în continuare pentru bolnavii, care îi știm pe nume și alții care au nevoie, mijlocirea în rugăciune e foarte importantă înaintea Domnului. Să nu uităm că săptămâna care vine, cu ajutorul Domnului, fratele Liviu Țiplea va fi cu noi, de vineri începând, și vom avea serviciu și vineri seara, veniți la casa Domnului, important, suntem în preajma sărbătorii de mulțumire, duminică va fi sărbătoarea mulțumirii, duminica pe data de 20, împreună cu fratele Liviu, și vom avea un serviciu special în care copilașii vor slăvi pe Domnul, corul și noi toți ne vom închina lui Dumnezeu. Nu uitați, frații bărbați, avem întâlnirea de sâmbătă la ora 10 cu capii de familie. Vă rog să faceți, să lăsați toate ale voastre și veniți, pentru că este important pentru bunul mers al lucrării Domnului din locul acesta. Acum, fără altă să zăbovim la alte lucruri, cântăm în continuare Domnului și ne vom închina și vom asculta apoi cuvântul.
Haideți să rămânem în aceeași cântare, 628, dar aș vrea puțin să cântăm puțin mai repede. Haideți să mergem puțin mai vioi, da? Când și-l văd pe Iisus pe pământul acesta ca serv, dar plin de dragoste și har. Și-l văd pe Iisus pe pământul acesta ca serv, dar plin de dragoste și har. Zăresc în amara-i suferință și mântuirea ce mi-o dândar. Atunci spun, măresc stăpânitor, ce mare e, ce
Stăteam la ușă și vedeam mâna acolo la ieșire și îmi spunea așa, frate,
știi care e cel mai dulce verset, care e cea mai dulce strofă din cântarea asta pentru mine? Și mi-a spus ei numărul 5, când mă apasă sarcini mari și grele, când sufletul mi-e trist până la mormânt, el se apleacă plin de mângâiere și mi-a tot chinul de orice legământ. Când mă apasă sarcini mari și grele și sufletul e trist până la mormânt, el se apleacă plin de mângâiere și-mi ia tot chinul de-orice
strofa a patra din cântarea în limba engleză, pentru că astea două sunt absolut la fel, aproape identice.
Când Domnul bun mă va chema la sine și când voi sta uimit în fața sa,
și dacă vă uitați la cântarea How Great Thou Art, ce mare ești, cel care a făcut aranjamentul muzical este Dr. Jan Staneschi, care a fost directorul seminarului din București. So, le-am spus fraților, a fost un muzician deosebit și am avut deosebirea să-l cunosc și să fim la o nuntă acolo undeva pe Dobrogea cu corul din Poparusul unde mergeam eu și să-l avem chiar în mașină împreună cu soția lui și să dirigeze corul acolo. Este minunat cum Dumnezeu ne ia de pe toată fața pământului să fim uniți în cântare și să strigăm ce mare ești. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and dare proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great, O Lord, how great, O Lord. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great, O Lord, how great, thou art. De ce cântăm imnuri? Stați bine acolo, așa vă puteți... Foarte bine, mulțumesc. Eu iubesc organiștii. Eu am cunoscut notele înainte să cunosc literele, că tatăl meu se ocupa de cor și de fanfare, unde am crescut, acolo în biserica de la țară, din Bihor. De ce cântăm imnuri? Am făcut un agreement în seara asta, că o să vorbesc în engleză, așa-i? Ok. Let me tell you something first. Un român care vorbea limba engleză, eu zis cineva, bă, dar ai un heavy accent, vorbești cu un accent foarte dur. Și el a zis, da, dar gândesc cu creierul. So, maybe my English accent is a little bit heavy accent, but I use my brain. So I'm praising God for the opportunity to be here. Why do we sing hymns? And we don't sing contemporary music. Oh. Să nu uit. Fratele Simi Tonea, mi-a încredințat salut pentru câteva familii, pentru familia Mici, pentru familia Ilcău și mai sunt o familie care nu o pomenesc, că nu o văd aici și Domnul să-i binecuvinteze, Domnul să-i ocrotească. Matthew chapter 26, verse 30, Matei 26, 30. Let's read that word, Matthew chapter 26 and verse 30. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. After celebrating the Lord's Supper, Lord Jesus Christ with the disciples, they sang a hymn. In Greek, the word is hymnos. And then that's why we have the word hymn. So Cornilescu translated cantaria. You know why? Because the synonym for hymn is canticle. So it's cantaria. After they sang cantaria, they went to the Garden of Gethsemane, toward the Mount of Olives. So that's why we are singing hymns. We cannot take elements from the worldly music and to use them to worship God. No. There is no such a Christian rock. Some of you, maybe you remember a pastor, Simeon Cure, yes? And Simeon Cure, he asked some youth there that were singing a kind of, this worldly rhythm and stuff like that. And he said, what are you singing here? And they said, we are singing Christian rock. And Simeon Cure said this, if will be a Christian rock, when it will be a Christian drug. So since the devil is not Christian, his music cannot be Christian, amen? You don't agree with me? I was expecting a very loud hallelujah. Because one is the music that is honoring our God, and the other is the music that is honoring the God of this world. Amen? So that is why we sing hymns. Now, I promise a personal testimony. So, am fost challenged să spun cum am intrat eu în lucrare. De ce am ajuns păstor? Cum am simțit eu chemarea Domnului? And it's very important for the youth, for those young ones among us this evening. That is why I will do it in English. To put a little bit of smile of your faces, you know. The first sermon that I delivered was when I was 8 or 9 years old. Look at Brother Mitch. You know, I grew up in a house of a minister. My grandpa was a pastor in the church where I grew up. So they were on the field working. All my grandparents, my parents. And what I did, I just gathered together all kids in the street. In the house where my grandpa used to live. And I put there a table and I said, this is the pulpit. And I asked one of my right side, I said, you will lead the songs. And the other one will pray when I will read the word of God. I was the preacher. So I preached, and believe it or not, I administered to them the Lord's Supper with bread and water. I believe it's not a sacrilege. I believe I didn't offend God on that. That was laid on my heart. Because I saw since my childhood, as my grandpa, every Saturday at noon, he ended up at any kind of work. He shaved, he dressed nice, and he walked to the villages where he served as a pastor besides our village. When they turned on the, not the lights, lighting the lamp, that time, he was right there, Saturday evening, for the time of prayer. Next day, Sunday, he preached in 3 churches, and then walking back home, arriving in the middle of the night, and Monday morning, starting to work, he was self-supporting himself. Self-supporting. He didn't get one penny from the Baptist Association, Baptist community. I remember when he was, I was a little bit, I was a young man that time. Brother Aurel Tank, I don't know how many know used to know him, but he said, look, come to the Baptist community and we would like to do something like a pension for you. And my grandpa said, no. I want that day that all my reward to be in full. I don't receive anything. So being moved by this, when I graduated from high school, 1976, I'm an old man, yes? You can see that starting snowing in Bay Area. So when I was 19 years old, I graduated from high school. My dad came to me, we were there in the schoolyard, and he said, do you consider to attend Baptist Theological Seminary in Bucharest, Romania? And I had my reasons and I said, look, I don't consider this. If God wants me in the ministry, either Americans will come to Romania to teach me theology, or God will take me to America to teach me theology. Now, it was another step. I went to Bucharest, Romania to take the exam of admission for Polytechnic University to become a mechanical engineer. And I had 2 exams of mathematics, was analytic mathematics and algebra. And then you have to choose even from engines or physics. So I decided to go for engines because always I love mechanics. And I went there at the first day of exam, analytic mathematics. And you know, I was so happy that I knew how to represent that chart to calculate the points on the axle X and on Y and to draw it. And I circled the final result. I was number 100 in that amphitheater. On my desk in front of me was the my ID with my picture. So the supervisor came and he said, you know that you are not allowed to do that, to circle the result. Why? Because you have your name written on the corner, overlapped with the paper and stamped with the seal of the university. And I said, that, why? Because that sign circling the result, it's a sign that will give us the idea that you cooperate with one of the graders. So you'll get a good grade, even if you are not performing very well. And I said, sir, tovarish was in that time. I said, look, I am first time in my life in Bucharest. I don't know anyone here. Give me another paper and I'll write it again, not circling the result. And he said, I cannot do that. But what can you do? You just put in a parenthesis what is wrong, cut it, and then write again. And I did that. You know how was the heartbeat of my heart? Up to the ceiling. And I went to the dorm, those that know Bucharest in Cotroceni. So I went there, and I went on my knees, and I promised the Lord, I said this, Lord, if you will work, that they will give me the grade that I deserve. I don't ask for higher, not of course for less, but if they give me the grade that I deserve, and I will be admitted to this school, I promise that 5 years of my study, when I will be here for becoming a mechanical engineer, will be 5 years when I will have the first thing first in my mind to prepare to follow my grandfather in the ministry and to serve you. So, long story short, after passing the, taking the other two exams, when my father called, we were all every day working on the field. I know how to cut the grass with the scythe. I don't know how many of you here are able to do that. I grew up like that. So I asked my dad. My dad made a phone call, and he got the answer. And I said, what is the answer? And he said, you are admitted. So I said, what's the GPA? He said, whoever will ask for that, what is important, you are there. So praise God. I had all 5 years scholarship. So let me tell you this. What follow after this, I don't know how many of you here are familiar with navigators. Navigators, they came from America to teach underground classes. I was one of those students in that time when I studied in Bucharest, Romania. So this is not all. 1989, the fall of Iron Curtain, was 13 years later after I made that statement to my dad. If God wants me in the ministry, Americans will come to America to teach me theology, or God will take me to America to teach me theology. 1993, 17 years later that I made that statement, Christian Training Foundation, located in Charlotte, North Carolina, working with Central Baptist Theological Seminary. They took Central Baptist Theological Seminary to Romania. And one of Brother Costea's relatives, Benny, was my classmate. So we were together there for 3 years in Master of Divinity program. So first thing first, Americans came to America to teach me theology. When I learned English after graduation from university, I didn't know why I learned English. I had two purposes, to be able to read books in English and to be able to translate for visitors. But now, I was in that pew, learning Greek language that was taught in English. After first test, the final of English grammar, I told my wife, I will not continue. I felt having like 1,000 pounds going through the bed. And my wife said, I didn't send you there. If you don't feel good, I will take you to the hospital. When I heard about hospital, I said, no, better go to school. So I went to school in 1996, I graduated. Believe it or not, 1997, Central Baptist Seminary said, we'll take three of you. Benny Costea, Ilie Tinku, and George Mudhak. And we will take you to Central Baptist Theological Seminary in America for doctoral program. If someone wants from me proofs that God called me in the ministry, what I uttered when I was 19 years old, it happened later. Americans coming to America to teach me theology, and Americans taking us to America in the doctoral program. The first, one very detail, just to stir up your desire to visit the Holy Land. The first class in doctoral program, first course, was a study trip to Israel for 16 days. 8 days in the old city of Jerusalem, 4 days in the upper side there to up to Mount Hermon and Galilee and that area, and 4 days near Beersheba, going down to Beersheba, the city of Arad. You know, there is a city of Arad in southern Israel. So you know what's happening? When you visit Israel, your Bible has another meaning for you. Your preaching is totally changed. So I encourage all of you, you know, the best way to spend your life on the earth is to be witness for our Lord Jesus Christ and to be a minister of the gospel, to bring the greatest, glorious, good news to people that are lost. Son of God, who is greater than him? No one came on this earth to seek and to save that which was lost. So if you want to work with him, that will be great. So may the Lord touch your hearts, and may the Lord work in your hearts. And when you feel the call, you will say, as others said, "Here I am, Lord." You remember Isaiah, "Here I am, Lord, send me." May the Lord help you to do so. Amen. Haideți să mergem la următoarea cântare. Azi, Iisus, îți vorbește iar. Oh, înainte de cântare, surorile Naomi și surorile Dumbrav vor avea o cântare și după aia mergem noi la cântarea asta. Bine că n-am uitat de tot. La bătrâneță uiți. Cineva m-a zis, nu ești bătrân, nu mai ești de mult.
Cer, vom ajunge
You combine Romanian with English, yes?
Very well.
So, frați și surori, hai să explic asta românește, pentru că ceilalți o să înțeleagă în engleză. Sper că n-ați venit în America cu Biblia Patriotului Român. Și care e Biblia Patriotului Român? Nu vreau să aud de engleză. Acum, fiecare generație are o responsabilitate. Cei care suntem mai în vârstă, am spus de când am venit în America, știți care e responsabilitatea noastră? Să transferăm la noua generație valorile în care am crescut noi, dar în limba în care ei le pricep. Eu am întâlnit tineri care spun, frate, știi de ce mă duc la biserică acolo cu frații români? Zic, de ce? Numai ca să respect pe tata, dar mă duc degeaba, că nu înțeleg nimic. Și ce s-a întâmplat mai târziu? Nu i-am mai văzut în biserică. Când l-am întâlnit pe unul, am zis, dar de ce nu te mai duci? Zic, după ce să mă duc? Și așa nu pricep nimic. Deci, aveți grijă. La noi e simplu în Castro Valley. De la capă până la sfârșit engleză. Biserică engleză și nu avem treabă. Toți românii vorbesc engleză care sunt acolo. Dar, pentru că sunteți o biserică cu două generații, frații mai în vârstă, aveți o responsabilitate enormă. Prețuiți ce aveți mai scump. Știți ce aveți mai scump? Viitorul, noua generație. Și acum pentru noua generație, pentru tineri, pay respect to those that don't speak very well English, but they invested money, hours of work, days of work, lots of things to offer you this sanctuary, yes, and facilities. They struggle to bring you here. Respect them, honor them. Și ca să înțeleagă și frații bătrâni le spun, știți ce le-a spus la tineri, cei care nu înțelegeți engleză? Responsabilitatea lor știți care este? Să vă respecte, pentru că ați investit bani, energie, timp de lucru și tot, ca să le oferiți un sanctuar, să-i aduceți până aici. Și responsabilitatea lor să vă respecte. Mă rog ca Domnul să vă dea înțelepciune, ca să știți cum să îmbinați și nevoile celor vârstnici și nevoile celor tineri. Pentru că ei se vor duce, cum s-au dus în alte părți, să caute. Oferiți-le aici și îmbinați limba română cu limba engleză. Eu n-am venit să vă dau lecții și sfaturi în seara asta. Eu nu m-am venit să vă spun din experiența pe care am văzut-o până la vârsta asta. Domnul să ne dea înțelepciune să știm cum să procedăm. Vreau să nu uit ceva. Vali, dacă vrei să mă ajuți cu o hârtie acolo, cei care vor să ținem legătura și aveți întrebări din ceea ce o să vorbim în seara asta sau din alte întrebări, din the end times theology, teologia vremurilor sfârșitului sau alte lucruri și vreți să mă întrebați, o să iau lista cu e-mail-urile, vă trimit un e-mail la toți ca să aveți și e-mail-ul meu. E-mail-ul meu e foarte simplu, foothillbaptist.cv de la Castro Valley @att.net. Este foarte simplu. So, aveți libertatea asta și putem să comunicăm. Haideți să mergem la următoarea cântare. Hai să-i căutăm numărul. Azi Iisus îți vorbește iar. O găsi cineva numărul? 576. O să cântăm primele trei românește, deci toate trei sunt de fapt ale cântării și după aia cântăm și versiunea în limba engleză. 576, azi Iisus îți vorbește iar.
Azi Iisus îți vorbește iar, face iubit cuvânt și îți vestește un mare har, face iubit cuvânt. Harul său iartă toate, are tale păcate, sfânt cuvânt cât de scump, ce minunat cuvânt.
Cele trei strofe în limba engleză. Wonderful words of life. Minunatele cuvinte ale vieții. Este versiunea în limba engleză. Muzica la fel, nu să puteți să-ți place.
Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Let
ar fi foarte simplu dacă m-aș pune să predic mesajul care l-am avut dimineață la Castro Valley. Psalmul numărul 2. timpurile lui Dumnezeu, God's timetable. Ce se întâmplă în prezent? Ce va face Dumnezeu în viitor? Și care sunt perspectivele noastre în prezent? Dar, pentru că a fost the challenge, provocarea ca să avem mai multe lucruri, o să fie din fiecare câte puțin. Mă întorc înapoi către tineri. Pentru noi, cei vârstnici, nu este problemă ce Biblie folosim, așa-i? Hai să vă spun celor vârstnici ce a spus cineva într-o biserică pe care am păstorit-o. Mi-a spus așa, frate, noi știm pe ce cale mergem. Pe noi nu ne mai întoarce nimeni înapoi. Ocupați-vă de tineri să meargă pe calea asta și noi stăm lângă dumneavoastră. Vreau să vă spun un secret. Toți cei care au stat lângă cuvânt și lângă păstor îmi scriu astăzi mesaje. Unii sunt slujitori în biserici. L-am auzit pe unul predicând la Curtici și era în clasele 1-4 când am predat religie imediat după căderea comunismului. Și când a citat un verset din Timotei, a zis: versetul ăsta l-am învățat pe de rost când fratele Ghiță Monsoc ne-a predat religie la școală și ne-a pus să învățăm versete pe de rost. Generația cu părul cărunt. Și ce-i spune Apostolul Pavel lui Timotei? Din pruncie cunoști Sfintele Scripturi. Cine l-o fi învățat? E un alt verset care vorbește despre credința lui Timotei care s-a sălășluit întâi în bunica ta, Lois, și apoi în mama ta, Eunice. Frații mei, dacă vreți, cântările sunt frumoase, mie îmi place să cânt, dar deasupra oricărui lucru, cea mai mare responsabilitate în familie este să-i învățați versete pe de rost. Eu vreau să vă spun, cele mai multe versete care le știu ca predicator, le-am învățat la studiu biblic într-o sală, cât jumătate din asta. Acolo eram toți, de la 9 la 12, de la cel mai mic, de la sugar până la cel mai vârstnic. Când plângea la mic, ieșea afară un pic, să-l liniștea, l-aducea înapoi. Dar, și-am stat pe laviță, știți ce aia? Bancă fără spătar. Dar de aia Dumnezeu mi-a dat coloană dreaptă în lumina cuvântului. Rămas o coloană dreaptă. Pentru că în fiecare duminică dimineața ne ridicam unul câte unul să spunem versetul de aur pe de rost. Atunci le-am învățat. Cele mai multe. În studenție am învățat poezii pe de rost. Stăteam în stații de troleibuz, autobuz, mi le scriam pe hârtii mici. Și mă duceam, eu nu știu, la capul, la o margine de stație, până venea troleibuz, autobuzul, și repetam și le spuneam în biserică, duminica. Puneți cea mai mare valoare în acest univers și pe acest pământ, cuvântul lui Dumnezeu în inimile lor. Nu vreau să dezvolt subiectul acesta, dar uitați-vă ce îi spune Apostolul Pavel lui Timotei, care e acum păstor. Și scrie cele două epistole pastorale. Ce ai auzit de la mine, învață pe alții, care la rândul lor vor învăța pe alții. Vă rog, frați și sori în vârstă, luați Biblia ca responsabilitatea unei generații care are să transfere noii generații. Noi avem traducerea Cornilescu, recunoscută de profesori în seminarii ca una dintre cele mai bune traduceri din lume. Slăvit să fie Domnul că ne-a dat această traducere. Nu, mă întorc la ei. Ei au o problemă. Care versiune? So, what is the best, which is the best version of the Bible in English? You will find people, which has they are New King James only. They are very angry and stubborn, and very making pressure someone to admit King James only. It's a very hard language. Didal. So one of the kids in the church, he was asked, what do you know about God? And he knew something about the song, How Great Thou Art. What I know about God is our God does art in heaven. So el face artă în ceruri. Așa o înțeles eu, din engleza veche. Frumos, Dumnezeul nostru încă lucrează, ia? Domnul Iisus a spus, eu lucrez, Tatăl meu de asemenea lucrează. Vreau să vă spun că am întâlnit, I met King James only. And I asked them, how many mistakes they have to be in a thing to be wrong, not to be, as you pretend, inspired, the only inspired Bible. How many mistakes? And it is very clear, only one, yes? Please turn your Bibles to James chapter 1, verse 1 in English, Romanian Iacov, capitolul 1, versetul 1. What is the name in Greek in James chapter 1, verse 1? It's Iacobu, Iacob. Iacov tradus. Nu intrăm în detalii de ce îi V la unii și B la alții. Explicăm cu altă ocazie. You know how is English? James. That is nowhere in the manuscript of that epistle named James. There's no James. That's a mistake. As they put Jacob in the Old Testament, they should put Jacob in the New Testament. Amen? That's right. You go to the book of Romans. Let's turn to the book of Romans. Book of Romans chapter 8, verse 16. King James is saying, the Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Is that correct? No. Holy Spirit is a person. Yes? Holy Spirit is not a thing to say itself. That's in King James. You know how is in New King James? Holy Spirit himself. You know, King James only, they hate those that are agreeing with New King James. I am using New King James. There are several other theological reasons why I am not using NIV, why I am not using New American Standard Bible. Let me give you an explanation. And it has to do with a very important theological issue. When you read in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, and it's written, your seed, the seed of the devil, those living in the darkness, following him, your seed, who are those that crucify our Lord, will break the heel. Yes? And they did that on the cross. And it's written there, the seed of the woman. You know how it's in New King James? With capital S. Why? Because the seed of the woman, it's our Lord Jesus Christ. Please understand, our Lord Jesus Christ didn't come from Mary. Incarnate God has nothing to do with fallen nature of mankind. If Jesus Christ will take something from Mary, then Jesus Christ in his body will not be perfect, 100% perfect. Perfect. You know, New American Standard Bible, on the, one of the editions, are saying the descendants of Mary. No, no, no. Lord Jesus Christ is not a descendant of Adam, yes? Do you know the Bible talks about the first Adam and the second Adam? First Adam having a beginning of the human race, yes? Second Adam has a beginning of those that are born again. Someone in Christ, he is a new creation. 2 Corinthians 5:17. So that is why, if you want theology, you set aside New American Standard Bible. I recommend, and it's no time, I will not spend time here, but if you want to study and not to be wrong, not to get wrong in theology, you have New King James Version or ESV, English Standard Version. It's the newest one. I believe only the newest one. But stay away of other translations. Someone asked me about Reader's Digest Bible. I said, give me a break. Leave me alone with that. I need the Word of God, nothing else. Someone in our church came to me and said, Pastor, I'm so sorry. My heart is broken. I offer a good Bible to my grandchildren, and I found them reading the Message Bible. You know what is the Message? It is one of the most horrible, disgraceful affront that it's ever written against the word, written word of God, is the Message Bible. Eugene Peterson, a charismatic one that translated that, he said, oh, I want to be like in a street language that everyone will understand. No, no, no. God is not a beggar. God has his own word. Before you do that, you just pay attention that one day you give account to God. I'll give you one example. If you read in the Message Bible, the Lord's Prayer, you know how it sounds? It doesn't say, give us our daily bread. You know how it's saying? Give us 3 square meals a day. What is that? At the end of the prayer, when we read, yours is the kingdom and the glory and the power forever and ever. You know how it is in the Message Bible? You are ablaze, you are ablaze. No. Be very careful what version of the Bible you use, because it can lead you astray. Be aware of what you listen to. What blogs are you reading? Very famous now, Calvinism, Neo-Calvinism. We can talk about this, but not now. Replacement theology, one of the most dangerous things. You know what is replacement theology? Romanians know very well. Oh, God is done with Israel. God replaced Israel with the church. I'll translate this for the Romanian speaking. Cea mai periculoasă teologie este teologia înlocuirii. Oh, Dumnezeu a terminat cu Israel. Dumnezeu acum lucrează cu biserica. No, Dumnezeu n-a terminat cu Israelul. Când am fost ultima dată aici, am explicat din Fapte 15, nu mai intru în detalii. Dumnezeu are un popor dintre neamuri, care e biserica, care a început cu evrei, cu apostoli. Și încă sunt evrei care sunt mântuiți și vin în biserica lui Iisus Hristos. Singur loc, nu alte organizații. Singur loc, biserica lui Iisus Hristos. Citiți Efeseni 2. Și al doilea, când a terminat cu biserica și o răpește, Dumnezeu se ocupă de cortul lui David. Nu credeți teologia înlocuirii. The one of the worst in the theology is the theology, the replacement theology. You know what is replacement theology? It's anti-Semitism preached from the pulpit by so many pastors. Americans, Romanians, It is anti-Semitism preached from the pulpit. To preach against Israel. You know how it's called the Holy Land? Read Isaiah chapter 8, verse 8. Your land, O Emmanuel. That territory, that land, belongs to Emmanuel. One day, on the hill of Zion, God will put the throne of his King, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. That's why it's called by Isaiah, your land, O Emmanuel. No, God didn't replace Israel with a church. Be aware what you read, what the Bible you use, and be aware what you are watching on YouTube. I want to give only one example, because we are approaching Christmas. And you see a lot of advertising in so-called The Chosen. Ah, sounds great, The Chosen. A movie about Lord Jesus Christ, disciples. That's a blasphemy against the incarnate God. In that movie, they want to bring Lord Jesus Christ just to the statue of a man. Just robbing him of his divinity. No. Jesus Christ, incarnate God, is the perfect man 100% and perfect God 100%. So be aware what you are watching, what you are reading, and what Bible you used. So I believe we'll skip a song and we'll move forward. I was asked to have an overview of the book of Revelation, and then to bring it to a summary in Romanian. Before we go to the book of Revelation, let me share with you some rules of interpretation. In order to understand the end times theology, you have to know the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation. And of course, all the prophets, even in the minor prophets, you will find a lot of information and prophecy concerning the end times theology. So I advise you, read those, study those. But in order to understand the prophecy, there are some rules that I want to mention this evening. First of all, is the historical rule. That means we have to look to the Word of God, the meaning in that time and in that culture when it was written. What did God want it to transmit, to send to us through that word? Historical, and if, of course, the Old Testament, it's history, yes? We have to understand it. And if you go in the book of Daniel in chapter 2, you'll understand history, yes? In the following chapter, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So the rules of interpretation are this. No one can say, you know what, brother, I see this here. And others say, but I see this. No. God doesn't speak in the same word, in the same passage, in several ways. No. The Word of God has only one meaning. We love those that are telling stories and spiritualizing everything. Oh, he's great. You listen to him. No. The interpretation is not what I see here. The interpretation is what comes out from there. That is why you study exegesis that are talking about the rules of interpretation of the Bible. Exe, coming out. This is why you have exit. Yes? Going out. Exegesis, what is coming out from the Word of God? So first of all is the historical rule. That's the second rule is literal. What means literal? As it is written. You don't interpret it according with your own mind or to the mind of the other commentators or other. It is according with your own mind. So look, let me give an example. Turn your Bibles to Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20 or chapter 20, how do you want to say here in California? We read here this: "Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and the great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And they, when I preach about this and explain the book of Revelation in Romanian, they say, someone can tie up an angel which is a spirit. I say, really, you don't believe it? I said, but do you believe Revelation chapter 9, verse 14? You know what is there? In the Great Tribulation is written this message for the Great Tribulation, saying to the sixth angel who had the trumpet, release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates. And as do you believe that? I said, oh, yes, yes, I believe. Really? I said. So those four angels could be bound up there on the river Euphrates. But you don't believe that God can take in bondage and tie up Satan because he's an angel. But the other four angels are angels as well, yes? When I work with Denton Bible Church for a study in Romania, leading this study in several churches in the western side of Romania, after spending time with the first book, Rules of Interpretation, I went to them for a test, and testing them, and just confirming that they are done with the book. And I asked them, do you believe in the 1,000 years, the millennial kingdom? So, oh, we don't believe that. I said, open up your Bibles and read in the book of Revelation chapter 20. And verse 4, and I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witnesses to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received his mark on their foreheads and or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. And I said, do you believe in the 1,000 millennial kingdom? So we don't. But I said, do you believe that those martyrs will arise, will be raised up, will arose from the dead? Will be arose from the dead? So yeah, I believe. And I said, who in the world is giving you the right to believe half of the verse, taking it literally, and the second half of the verse not taking it literally? He said, because and so our teacher in the seminary told us like that. I said, look, the rule of interpretation is take the word of God literal as it is written. And I will tell you this, even not knowing 100% what is there, you are never, ever wrong. This is the rule. Take it literal. You are never, ever wrong. So the third rule is grammatical. You remember when we were talking about the church, if we'll pass through the Great Tribulation or not. And we went to Ephesians chapter 5, as Lord Jesus Christ purified his church and his past tense. That means he already did. So the church doesn't need to go through the tribulation to be purified. It's very important to take and look in the text and look at the verbs and the nouns and everything and take the right grammatical interpretation and meaning. I want to give you an example from the Old Testament. When those two angels went to Sodom and Gomorrah, you read in Genesis 18 and 19 what happened there. So the Lord remained there with Abraham before his tent. But the other two, the angels, they went to Lot. And they had a message for Lot. You take your wife, your two daughters, and your daughters and sons-in-law, and you live. Now, Abraham was interceding before God. God said, should I hide from Abraham what I am having to do, what I am going to do with Sodom and Gomorrah? I know Abraham. He will teach his children. So I will tell Abraham everything about this. So Abraham said, God, the Lord, if there will be 50 people, are you going to kill, to destroy the righteous one with the evil ones? God said, no, I'm not going to do that. When Abraham saw that, he continued interceding before God for Sodom and Gomorrah. I'll be short. Long story short, he arrived at 10. Why did Abraham stop at 10? Because I heard pastors saying, oh, Abraham, you should go lower than 10, and God will help you, and God will hear you, and God will answer you, and Sodom and Gomorrah will not destroy. Abraham had no choice to go under 10. How do we know that? Knowing a little bit of grammar. So the Hebrew grammar is totally different than other grammars when you come to the number of the nouns. We have one is singular, yes. Two is plural. That is in Romanian, in English, in Greek, in the New Testament. One is singular, two is plural. When you go to the Hebrew grammar, they have singular when it's one, they have dual when they are two, and they have plural when they are three or more. Do you know that the Holy Trinity is in the first verse of the Bible? Where is the name Elohim? Bereshit bara Elohim. Et vashanaim, et haaretz. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So God there, Elohim, every noun that ends up in I am, im, it's plural, is three or more. There is the Holy Trinity. Someone said, oh, I didn't see Holy Trinity in the whole Bible. There is the Holy Trinity in the whole Bible, starting in the first verse, and you find it the whole Bible. So Lot misses his wife. I don't know, I would say Mrs. Lot. I don't know if that was the last name or not. Let's say the wife of Lot. The two daughters are four, yes? And then comes daughters of Lot, which is plural, minimum three. And the sons-in-law of Lot, which is plural, minimum three. So there are 10. According with Jewish, with Hebrew grammar. So that's why Abraham couldn't go lower than that. He will see, the family of my nephew should live of a high righteous standard, and God will save Sodom and Gomorrah. Unfortunately, they didn't live. God destroyed it. Why I gave this example? Not to tell you how much Hebrew I know. I know what others forgot. A little bit, but enough to study the Word of God. You have to study the Bible from a historical point of view, literal, grammatical, and dispensationalist view. What is a dispensation? A dispensation is a period of time. God has a time when he will work with the Gentiles, and there's the dispensation of Gentiles. Then God will work with Israel, and that's a dispensation for Israel, a period of time, when he will raise up the tent of David. Very clear in the Holy Scripture. So in order to understand the Bible, you have to look at it in a dispensationalist way. So the church is the church, Israel is Israel. So there are four rules of interpretation. Now, maybe 5 minutes. for the overview of the book of Revelation. So, book of Revelation is the only one book for which one God gave the outline. You know, people are writing the outlines of the book of the Bible, books of the Bible. Turn with me, please, to Revelation chapter 1, verse 19. Apocalipsa 1 cu 19. Revelation chapter 1, verse 19. Write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after this. Now, before we go to explain this outline of the book, let me a little bit explain the title of the book. Revelation. Oh, in Romania we have Apocalipsa. Oh, the apocalypse times, horrible things that will come. No, that is not horrible things. You know, apocalypse, you have, let me do this. I'll use this. Here, don't see my hand, yes? Apo means up, and calypsos, remove. For what purpose? That Lord Jesus Christ to be seen in the book. Revelation of Jesus Christ. The apocalypse of Jesus Christ. So, revelation of Jesus Christ. The whole book, it's about our Lord Jesus Christ. Revelation is not, oh, look into Armageddon, war will come. No. We as a church, we don't look for the great trouble, the great tribulation. You know how it's called in the Bible, the great tribulation? Great trouble of Jacob, not of the church. Great trouble of Jacob. So when you look in the Bible, in the beginning, the Lord Jesus Christ, it's revealed to John. That was in the past. John, the apostle, he saw the risen Christ, and he fell at his feet as dead man. The Lord touched him, and he said, don't be afraid. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the one that was dead, and I am alive forevermore. God said, wrote those things, what you saw. Then you write those things that you saw. Then you write the things which are. What are the things which are? Second part of the book of the book of Revelation is comprising chapter 2 and chapter 3. These are the times that we live in. And those seven letters to those seven churches, you know where is the secret? Each one of us should look in those letters and look to his own life and said, do I belong to the church in Ephesus? Did I leave my first love? You can see, oh, how I love Jesus. But tomorrow your life will not show it up. You have to come back to the first love. When you are there, clothed in white, witnessing Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you have tears in your eyes. You love him. And you sing the song about following him. And you sang that song, that verse, no turning back, no turning back. How many times did you turn back? How many times did I turn back? So go to every letter and decide where you belong and understand what is your problem and ask God to change your life, to bring you back. Then every local church on this earth should look in these seven messages and would say, brothers, are we the church in Ephesus? Are we the church in Smyrna? Oh, that will be a blessing, isn't it? Are we the church in Pergamos, in Thyatira? No, we don't like. Yes? Are we the church in Sardis? No, no, no. Are we the church in Philadelphia? It's love for brothers. Yes. You know, that church had nothing to be condemned by our Lord Jesus Christ. But they received a promise. Because you kept my word, I will keep you from the hour that will come all or on the above the inhabitants of the earth. We are not inhabitants of the earth. We are pilgrims on the earth. Our citizenship is in heaven. That is why that's a promise. We don't go through great tribulation. We don't need to be well done or medium rare in the fire. No. We are already cleansed by the power of the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. What follows chapter 4 and 5, the church is in heaven. Chapter 4, it's a glorious hymn for God. Chapter 5 is a glorious hymn for the Savior. Chapter 6 to 19 is the message of the Great Tribulation. Seven seals, seven trumpets, seven bowls. All of them follow by God's wrath and judgment and the wrath of the Lamb upon the inhabitants of the earth until that day that Christ will destroy the kingdom of Antichrist. In the beginning of that section, Revelation 6 to 19, you will see the rise of the kingdom of Antichrist. Don't expect of a worldly revival of the people on the earth to come to God and to fill the churches. No, no, no. Churches started in homes and maybe will end up in homes. We don't know. We want to be faithful witnesses. But in Revelation chapter 6, with all those horses and going is described, seven, going, moving forward, the rise of the kingdom of Antichrist. Until those trumpets and the punishments of God, judgments of God will come upon the inhabitants of the world, the earth, the kingdom of Antichrist being at the end destroyed. Revelation chapter 19, you read the second part. You will see the King of Kings and Lord of Lords coming with his church, with the saints, his church, clothed in white linen, riding white horses. Oh, brother, you tell me there will be horses in heaven. How they will breed there? How they will breed there? Let me ask you this. How were those three in the fiery furnace breeding in the middle of the fire and the fourth one walking around them when they came out, no smell of smoke? Who protected them and gave them air in the middle of fire? When in Daniel chapter 3, Nebuchadnezzar threw them in that fiery furnace. That's God's problem. I told one brother, you know, God's problem is to set up the thermostat. It's not my problem. When he sets up the thermostat, he will protect me and he will protect you. How will breathe there? That is not my problem. It's God's problem. My problem is to be ready for that very glorious moment when the rapture will come. Time is over. The rapture will come. We'll be taken up to heaven. 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 to 18. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, describing the events that will announce, will happen after we go to heaven. So, in this, after this part, things that will be after this, after the king will come, millennial kingdom will be consumed. That will come the new creation, new heavens and new earth. I have here 20 arguments why the rapture is totally different than the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But the time is off. So, românește. Cartea Apocalipsa este singura carte din Biblie căreia Dumnezeu îi scrie schița. Apocalipsa, capitolul 1, versetul 19, scrie lucrurile care le-ai văzut, cele care sunt și cele care vor fi după acestea. Și îl descrie pe Domnul Iisus care l-a văzut, Ioan l-a văzut pe Hristos, îl învia din nou, cel care este Alfa și Omega, începutul și sfârșitul. Lucrurile care sunt Apocalipsa 2 și 3. sunt lucrurile care sunt astăzi și ne privesc pe noi ca indivizi și ca biserică, frați și surori în biserică. Lucrurile care vor fi după aceea, biserica este sus, Apocalipsa 4 și 5, răpită, și apoi urmează creșterea împărăției lui Anticrist, Apocalipsa 6, până la distrugerea împărăției lui Anticrist, prin toate judecățile lui Dumnezeu. Veți vedea sigiliile, trâmbițele și potirile. Judecata finală, cine va scăpa de mânia mielului? Oamenii nu se vor pocăi atunci. Și se scrie în Biblie că vor face oamenii atunci. Vor blestema numele lui Dumnezeu. Tu vezi biserica acolo? Eu nu o văd. Nicăieri, între Apocalipsa 6 și Apocalipsa 19, prima parte, nu vei vedea cuvântul biserică. După aceea, în a doua parte, când vine și vin sfinții cu el. Și apoi, după împărăția de 1000 de ani, un cer nou și un pământ nou. Hai să întreb, dacă răpirea are loc astăzi, răpirea poate avea loc în orice moment, ești gata să pleci? Let me ask you, young man or young lady, if the rapture will come, because everything that happens on the earth gives us the right to believe that the rapture can take place any moment. Are you ready to go? You know what is the shortest commentary of the book of Revelation? I just preached to 1 week ago, I believe. WWW. We will win. You know how we will win? Not because we are strong. Through the blood of the Lamb. If you are not yet cleansed in the blood of the Lamb, there is power in the blood. Hai să mergem să cântăm cântarea aceasta și o să cântăm Vrei tu să scapi de păcat, sarcină, mai faceți colecta? Faceți colecta, vrei tu să scapi de păcat, sarcină? Mi se pare că este numărul 100, cât e, 127 sau cât e vrei tu să scapi de păcat, sarcină? Ce număr e? Cine mă ajută cu vrei tu să scapi de păcat, sarcină? Cât? Ai pus sus, ok, hai să cântăm. Vrei tu să scapi de păcat, sarcină, prin sângele sfânt al lui Iisus? Vrei tu să învingi râul din inimă, prin sfânt sânge al lui Iisus? E puterea ce minuni face sângele mielului. E puterea ce minuni face în sfânt sângele mielului. Vrei să fii liber de mari păcat, prin sângele sfânt al lui Iisus? Vin la păcat și vei vindeca, prin sângele
sângele.
It's your decision. God knows, maybe not today. I know about tomorrow. But if God is searching your heart, here is Brother Cornell, the deacon of the church, Brother Levi will come, share with them. And may the Lord bless you. And as we are before your Savior and our God, we're asking for the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of you, our Father in heaven, eternal God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit to be with us forever and evermore. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. So, dacă sunt întrebări, am înțeles că dacă sunt întrebări, acum transmisia e gata. Cineva vrea să mă întreabă sau pot să răspund acum, cu cea mai mare bucurie, pot să răspund. Dacă nu pot să răspund, răspund foarte bine.